Hi, I thought I'd sit outside to talk about this because it's so easy to fall into a virtual world, and you will be watching this through the virtual world, and so giving a bit of kind of external, physical, tangible reality might add a bit of perspective to what I want to talk about, which is the virtual world, the internet. Because whilst I wasn't in anywhere near right at the beginning, I've been online since about 2000, so it's a long time now, you know, nearly 16 years, isn't it? And there have been such massive changes, not only in the internet itself, but in the world as a result. And so I wanted to explore that a little bit. I'll try not to meander on for too incredibly long, but there's a lot to say. Because when it started up, and certainly when I joined it, it was a bit like the Wild West. Not that I've ever experienced the Wild West, but in the sense that there's a bird talking to me. In the sense that it was unregulated, it was managed by the people who were there, it was very expansive and complicated and confusing and mystifying to a lot of people. And there were things going on, as there are now, that were unhealthy, but there were also a lot of things going on which were imaginative and creative and seemed to develop some quite deep interactions between people from very different cultures. It was I found it certainly very valuable, and I know a lot of the people that interacted with me also were finding it very valuable. It was kind of utopian in the sense that there was no money exchanging hands, that what you put out there you literally gave away. So it was a real kind of sharing society. If, you know, someone put an image up there or their work up there, anybody could help themselves to it. I mean, people used to do things like put watermarks on things, but, you know, it didn't really have much effect because it ruined whatever they were putting up with the watermark. But you knew that you could communicate with whatever percentage of the world was at the time on it, and that they could make use of what you had to offer. And that felt quite powerful and influential, and also, as I said, very creative. I was inspired creatively a great deal by what was going on then, and made some very good friendships, some of whom I still know now, some of whom I've met, even though they were from other parts of the world. And it was fascinating. Then big business got involved, as it tends to do in pretty much anything where there's money potentially to be made, and took ownership of this space that actually doesn't really belong to anybody, offered services in return for social control of various different kinds, and for selling, in order to sell us things and to make money for themselves. Again, you know, it's part of the course, it's what humans tend to do, unfortunately. And in the early days, that wasn't too much of an issue, I don't think. You know, you could choose whether you wanted to participate in that side of it or not. And that has gradually developed and developed and developed until really there's precious little you can actually do without being part of that. And in many ways, we all run much of our lives through this tunnel of virtuality. So, you know, most of us do our banking online, for example. Many of us buy most of our stuff online and it arrives at the door, or fails to arrive at the door, which has been a problem that I've been having recently. But that's more to do with the post office than to do with the internet. And so we've become increasingly embroiled in these systems and therefore become dependent upon them. And once we're dependent upon them, those systems can start to pull our strings. And also, because once there's a certain, you know, the 100 monkey thing, once there are a certain number of people on the internet, once there are, there's a kind of tipping point beyond which you end up very much with the lowest common denominator rather than I was going to say aspiring, but that's the wrong word, a sort of inspirational, expansive world. And we're way past that now. You know, the appeal of the selfie, of self-indulgence, of the desperation to be liked and appreciated, even though it's not real, being liked and appreciated, the ability to stalk people that we are interested in, if that's what we choose to do, the ability to attack and harm people if we don't like them, and with relative impunity, even though there are attempts now to adjust that, it's not working. You know, it's certainly way, way behind that very destructive, abusive group mentality of dragging someone down simply because you don't like them. You know, I think we all know that if the people that were doing this were face to face with the person that they were attacking, they wouldn't say a thing. They only do it because they can get away with it. And that sort of mob mentality that has been gradually developing and now is spilled over massively into the political world arena. So you have groups like, for example, the far right or ISIS using social media to huge effect, because they know full well the power of that medium and the fact that you can manipulate people through a screen in a way that you can't manipulate them face to face. The techniques are not complicated, and there are a lot of vulnerable people sitting in their bedrooms desperate for somebody to validate them, to make them feel worthwhile, to give them a cause, for something to belong to. And it's so easy to suck people in like that. And so that's happening all over the place. And it is now having a major effect on world politics, on the social order, on people's safety. You know, it's now serious stuff, because it is spilling over massively in all sorts of different ways. And that doesn't mean that the potential benefits have been lost. They're still there. You know, it is, as with anything, a tool, and it's what we do with it. But human nature is such that we are rapidly, you know, careering towards the bottom of what, or the least, or the worst of what it can do. And whether or not we start to, you know, come up the other side and start growing up with it and becoming mature in the way that we handle it and the way that it is policed, if indeed that's even an acceptable thing to be doing. And I mean, in some senses it is, and in other senses it isn't. It's a moot point. You know, the world is not quite going to hell in a handcart, but things are not looking good. And a lot of that is to do with that kind of wildness of the internet and the fact that we don't really know what we're doing. And trying to catch up with what's actually happening without truly understanding how it's actually come about. And there are more groups now which are using it to good effect. There's still a lot of dinosaurs who don't understand it and who dismiss it, or who see what goes on in it as either meaningless or pointless. But there are other groups which understand, as I said, very well the powers and its benefits and its potentials. And I think to try and conclude, even though there is no conclusion to be drawn, because the experiment continues, and the way one manages it continues, you know, because I feel on the whole to be quite mature in how I use social interaction online. And part of that's to do with what I've, the work that I've done and who I am, and the fact that I'm considerably older than an awful lot of people online. And some of it is to do with learning how to use it to one's benefit, or to be the benefit of whatever bits of the world that you touch. And that's an art. And I think a lot of people could do with learning that art. I'm not saying my way of doing it is the only right way of doing it, far from it. But I do think that a lot of people need to learn how to use it much better than they actually do. And to, almost to sort of conclude this particular video, this whole people thing, which seems to have gone very quiet recently in the last couple of days, few days. Most of you will know about it. It's an app which rates people, human beings, and it can rate them professionally, as friend, or romantically. And I don't need to explain the potential pitfalls of that. I mean, you know, for example, if you're romantic, you were romantically involved with somebody, you're not going to put them on people while you're still in a relationship with them. You're going to put them in people because you've had a splitting up and you're hugely resentful. There are all sorts of horrors that can take place as a result of rating human beings on a star system, however you set it up. And I think it's kind of a particular low point for the internet that this has come about, and that anybody ever thought it was a good idea. And the internet has been outraged by and large and said, you must stop it. And the people who are setting it up have had to move the goalposts over and over again. I mean, I'm hoping it just never goes up at all. But it's interesting that people are so outraged about it and doing something about that. And I think that shows that those who are against such a ridiculous concept and the potential consequences of that are beginning to see, I think, how powerful one can be for good, for social change, to benefit us, despite the best efforts of large businesses that have tried to take away that kind of opportunity for years now. We still can do it. And I think that's kind of the conclusion I want to come to, that we can continue to do valuable things with this medium, despite how it's kind of degraded and deteriorated in the ways that the worst of us make use of it, or the worst of us makes use of it, if you see what I mean.